I'm James Howell, and this is 11th Heaven Critical Suplex, an extended look at Grasshopper Manufacture's 2007 game No More Heroes, written and directed by Suda51. Heaven 5. Holly Summers with Brady Hartel. I'm going to set critical analysis aside for this episode to look at some of the game's mechanics. To get to that material, I'm just going to fast forward through all the usual preparations. We're going to look at the four different beam katanas available to Travis. Each beam katana has different properties, and I'll break those down into five categories. High combos, low combos, optimal strategies for dark stepping, the kind of damage you can expect from sword clashes, and, my absolute favorite, countering enemy attacks. So, first up, we have the Bloodberry, Travis's starting sword and the sword that I'm using for this series playthrough. We'll start with its combo. Each sword has two combo sets, one for high attacks and another for low. Travis's high combo only hits four times before going into cooldown. High attacks with the Bloodberry are fast, but they do less damage than low. Low attacks are slower and they do more damage. You get the most out of the Bloodberry by switching between high and low combo sets with the Wii Remote. The combos reset when you switch between high and low, so you can avoid the cooldown. Now for dark stepping. The combos still hit their limit and go into cooldown during dark step, so varying it up is important here too. Now let's look at sword clashes. A successful sword clash will almost always kill the specific enemy that Travis has engaged. However, you also get collateral damage out of a victory. So here, Travis wins a clash, and I get a horizontal attack prompt. This doesn't kill the second enemy in close quarters, but it does knock him off his feet, leaving him open for a down attack. Vertical attacks have a different effective range. Go. This time, the guy on the right stays on his feet. Think of the vertical range as a cone. Here I've got a bunch of enemies fanning out in front of Travis, and a vertical finishing move knocks them all on the ground, leaving an easy pile to clean up. Now we're going to look at my favorite, parries. If you click the Z button and raise Travis's sword at the exact moment the enemy's attack connects, you'll stun them. During that stun, Travis can perform a riposte, which is an instant attack that's equivalent to the sword's low charge attack. To do this, you hit the A button while the enemy is still in its stun animation. Parries can be very good for crowd control. During the half second after stunning an enemy, Travis is invincible, giving you enough time for that riposte. You only need to parry one enemy's hit to trigger that move. The Bloodberry is the weakest, so on Bitter, it takes several ripostes to kill even a basic enemy, as we're seeing here. Eventually, though, when their health is low enough, Travis will go for a decap. Enemies with their own beam katanas have much more health than regular enemies, and they take more parries to kill. And a word on timing the ripostes. You need to hit the enemy toward the end of its stun animation in order to trigger the attack. If you attack too soon, the enemy will be vulnerable, but you'll only land normal attacks while they're staggered. We'll look at that timing in greater detail in a second. Next, we'll look at the Tsubaki, which Travis gets from Naomi's lab. The Tsubaki does more damage per hit, and it has some more interesting combos than the Bloodberry. The Tsubaki has an 8-hit high combo, which, on its own, is enough to wear down a normal enemy almost entirely. It looks particularly fast and cool during a dark step, though even here it's not enough to finish an enemy who starts at full health. The Tsubaki really shines in its low combo. Travis throws a few kicks into this combo, and those kicks instantly stun enemies and open them up to wrestling moves. However, while the kicks do stun damage, they don't do normal damage, making the low combo weaker overall. That said, the low combo is great for crowd control. The kick has a really good horizontal and vertical range, and you can use the first kick of his combo to stun many enemies at once. This can be useful for getting some breathing room in a crowd. The stuns last quite a while, too. And if you don't want to retreat, the stuns can give you time to focus on single enemies amid a group. Now let's look at sword clashes. The Tsubaki's horizontal finisher has better width and depth than the Bloodberry's, though its collateral damage is still pretty weak. You'll do best following up with a series of down attacks if one of these connects. Now we're going to look at the timing on parry attacks. As noted before, if you attack the enemy too soon, Travis will just do his normal attack combo. You need to wait until the second half of the enemy's stun animation to connect with a riposte. Travis actually moves forward a bit during this riposte, so the range is much better than the Bloodberries. Now let's look at how to time a parry in the middle of a group. Even if you're not locked on to the exact enemy that Travis parries, you can still perform the riposte as long as he did, in fact, parry someone's attack. To practice getting the timing down, you might look at the enemy's feet during the stun animation. When its feet are closer to landing, that's the time to attack. Now we're going to look at the Tsubaki Mark II. This is the laser equivalent of a club, and it has the advantages and disadvantages that you might expect from that weapon type. Naomi will develop this if you bring her the US military secret documents that Travis acquires at the end of his fight with Holly Summers. The Tsubaki Mark II has fewer hits per combo, but each hit does massive damage. The combo is also much slower. Here, for example, the high attacks hit at the speed of the Bloodberry's low attacks, but landing four of them is enough to kill a standard enemy at full health. That last hit does an especially large amount of damage. The Tsubaki Mark II uniquely has a longer combo with low attacks. Those attacks do less damage, and I think they're just a hair slower than the high attacks as well. The normal high, weak, low, strong properties are reversed. During a dark step, most attacks do a little bit less damage than normal, but again, you can get more hits out of the Tsubaki Mark II during that dark step. The difference appears to be negligible though, so it's not a difference that you really need to change your strategy for. Sword clashes with the Tsubaki Mark II have decent collateral damage. As you can see here, the vertical attacks have a conical area of effect. The horizontal attacks also have a wide berth. And the riposte does an incredible amount of damage with the Tsubaki Mark II. Here, I can take a normal enemy's head clean off, even when it's at full health. And one more time. The riposte doesn't guarantee a decap, though, since harder enemies can absorb the damage without dying instantly. You should clear them out with the second parry. And in groups, the Tsubaki Mark II's riposte is less crowd control and more crowd extermination. This brings us to the final sword, the Tsubaki Mark III. Travis's master, Thunder Ryu, dies at the start of the fight against Speedbuster. At the end of that fight, you get his katana, and Naomi uses that as raw material for the Tsubaki Mark III. This sword does less damage per hit, but it has the longest combo of all the swords. It's really the perfect sword for Travis, since the weakness of each hit allows the combo to go on just a bit longer, making it a very flashy weapon. Here, the high combo takes 9 hits to finish off a normal enemy. And the finishing flourish is fun stuff. Travis's low combo is slower and does more damage, as is mostly standard for the other swords, but the moves are no less flashy. I think it's really neat that the ultimate sword works as hard to fill out Travis's character, how he perceives himself or who he wants to be, as it works to empower the player to meet the intensity of later game combat. And the sword really comes into its own during a dark step. Dark step attacks do less damage than normal, which really lets Travis drag out the combo into something that looks insanely flashy and acrobatic. The collateral damage after a sword clash with the Tsubaki Mark III is insane. Travis's range for a horizontal finisher is less a plane and more a ring. The vertical finisher has a pretty good range too, and while it won't hit the enemies behind Travis, it will still hit enemies if they're to the immediate left or right. The ripostes with the Tsubaki Mark III are as flashy as the standard combos because they're actually combos themselves. Travis makes a little hop if you press the A button once after a parry. It takes 2 of these to kill an enemy with a normal amount of health. If you hit the A button twice, Travis will perform a second hit after twirling in the air. The second hit does as much damage as the first, which is usually enough to finish off whoever's in Travis's path. Let's watch those in slow motion one more time to catch the difference. Here's the one-hit hop attack. And here's the attack if you hit the button twice. The hop attack has decent range for collateral damage, but the two-hit attack has great range to go really deep into a crowd of enemies. If anyone's left standing after Travis kills his initial target, he'll actually adjust the direction of his attack toward whoever's nearby. And for those enemies with a lot of health, the Tsubaki Mark III has a third hit if you press the A button one more time. I really like the parry and riposte attacks. So much that, for the gameplay section of this video, I'll defeat melee enemies exclusively with ripostes, and use wrestling moves on the rest. And now I'm heading over to the interview mic to speak with this episode's guest. Joining me today is Brady Hartel, UI designer and production artist with LabZero Games, specifically most recently credited on the 2D fighting game Skullgirls and the recently crowdfunded action RPG Indivisible. He's probably worked on 80% of every piece of media you have consumed if you are into Japanese, English, Japanese video games, and anything like that. And you know, I go back quite a ways. Brady, welcome.
Oh, thank you for having me. Japanese, English, Japanese, that's a... localizing it back to the original Japanese.
Right.
But no, thanks for having me. I'm really honored that you would have me for this.
Oh, totally. Well, I mean, you and I both have a long-standing relationship with the game, and also I remember when it came out, I mean, we talked about it quite a bit when it came out in terms of, you know, talking about the design, strategy, and stuff like that. So honestly, when I thought about doing this project, you were like the first person I thought of, like, oh, I gotta get Brady in on this.
Oh, that makes me feel great. Oh, I feel loved now.
Yeah, you and I go back quite a ways. I think actually this year will be our decade of friendship, I think.
Really? 10 years? I guess. Well, yeah, because we met on Metal Gear Online, and then that came out in 2004, I believe.
And I'm remembering, let's see, I was writing an article on Metal Gear Online for the Kojima Productions 2006 E3 literature, and I was looking for people to interview, and I encountered you in the game as a complete unknown, as an enemy, as on the enemy team, and I was actually, I was into recording my game footage at the time and rewatching it afterward. I thought, that guy knows what he's doing. So I actually tracked you down onto the old insert credit forums, and turns out you had very good reason for knowing what you were doing.
Oh, yeah, because me and my buddy had spent a good month writing the strategy guide for the Metal Gear Online portion of the Metal Gear Solid 3 subsistence strategy guide. Like we had been immersed in it. And I remember we ended up, we had gotten like builds of the English version and everything, but there was nobody playing it but us. And we couldn't really like play one player. So we got the Japanese version and we played with the Japanese players and learned like all the tricks and figured out like all the weird flaws and everything of that game. And it was such a fun, thing. And I remember your name because, I remember there were so many, like that game had so many exploits to it. And I remember you played super well, but you were super fair about not exploiting the exploits and just ruining the fun of everybody. Like you were very good, but very fair. And I remember giving you a compliment about that in the chat.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, it's my approach to that is, I mean, if it's a single player game, I don't mind messing with some of the exploits. But with like a multiplayer game, it's, you know, with anything else, you know, when you're playing a game with other people, you go by the rules and you have rules to make the game fun to give restrictions. So I'm fine passing on exploits. I know that there are arguments for using those. That I think that there's reason behind that. I just don't do it.
Oh, I always thought, too, like, you always had, with those games, I felt like you had a fun approach to them. Like, you would explore all the sub-weapons and try to, like, trap people, and we would set up all these, like, multifaceted Rube Goldbergian traps where they would like run into a claymore and then hit like a sleep gas, and then we would set up all these crazy traps and stuff, so like in the capture the flag missions they would never be able to even get up. It was like running interference on these people, and it was all a valid strategy too, which is always super interesting to me. That's why like whenever you would like suggest like a certain way to play that wasn't exactly the way it was meant to be played, I would always be interested in what you had in mind, because it would always be this weird thing that either it was like, oh, I never thought of that, but it works, and it sort of throws off the mindset of the other team who is used to playing a certain way, and it's sort of like, oh, they wouldn't see that coming, and it's like, how do we adapt this so they continuously don't see it coming?
Yeah, that's the way I like to do it. And if I'm remembering right, a lot of your work has focused on single-player games, and also a lot of anime remasters. Like, I think you even worked on the remake of Miyazaki's Castle of Cagliostro, right? Yeah, that's right.
I even designed the manual for the PS3 version of No More Heroes.
Oh my god, did you really?
Yeah, I designed, because it was a conflation of the Japanese one. Yeah, I worked on it.
you're proving my point.
The motion control PS3 version.
Oh right, with the is it PS Move?
The Move. Yeah, I mean, yeah. I have it. I never really played through it though, because I played the crap out of this. I always kind of liked that Travis is a hero. He's like an absolute pervert, but he's like for 99% of it, he's not rewarded for being a pervert. Like, he's always shut down.
Yeah, exactly. I actually don't think he's ever rewarded for it. Oh no, he is. He is once during the
magician ending
fight. Well, I think at the beginning of No More Heroes 2, it opens up by him saying that he and Sylvia, never had sex.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I forgot about number two. But like I think that like the reason I like him is like I said, he's got like a sense of bravado, but he's completely fallible. Like he fails constantly, and like he's not like an ultimate badass like space marine.
Right.
He's usually like comically hurt and kind of fails upwards, really. Like
fails upwards. I have never heard that expression, but that is totally perfect for this character.
Well, if you think about it, like isn't like the only reason he's an assassin because he accidentally killed he accidentally got the job to kill Helter Skelter, and then because he needed money.
I think also I think the only reason he won the lightsaber off an eBay auction.
Yeah, yeah, and I think because he was out drinking or something. Like, I know that the story is a little muddled for his origin, but it was always interesting to me that, like, he was so, like, he's so full of himself, which is fun on its own. But in most games where the characters are full of themselves, they don't have that, like, fallibility. So, and he's, he's not undefeatable. If you look at, like, say the Indiana Jones movies versus the Tomb Raider movies, they're like the same premise, right? Like an archaeologist gets wrapped up in a dangerous plot and all that. And then in the Tomb Raider movies, Lara Croft is just, this kind of gun-toting, unkillable bullet machine.
Right.
Whereas in Indiana Jones, he's got that kind of swagger to him that Travis has, but like Travis... he kind of fails. Like, if you look at the first movie, in like the first 5 minutes, he barely survives getting the idol out, and then he loses the idol, and then he goes through this entire movie where he's just beaten up and he gets his ass kicked and stuff like that. And then once he finally manages to find the Ark of the Covenant, he doesn't even get to see what's in it, and then the American government takes it away from him. Like it's that's kind of like what I mean by failing upward. Like, that's why that movie Indiana Jones works, and I think like that's why Travis also works as a hero, because like he doesn't it doesn't come easy, and it you really feel like you're the underdog in this game, matter what he says.
Yeah, exactly. That's interesting because it is what sets the game apart from being just a regular power fantasy. I mean, it is a power fantasy in a way because you've got you have the structure for a power fantasy, right? Which is literally a game leaderboard. It's like start at the bottom and make your way up to top and be king nerd. But it's like even at the end of that, he's still living in a hotel and he still is. It's the whole UAA is a con show. He's basically gained nothing except the personal satisfaction of having found out what happened to his family.
Yeah, I mean, well, that's the thing too. It's for Travis, it's a power fantasy. Like it is his power fantasy to be able to do all this stuff and do things like his Japanese anime and the manga he reads and stuff. Like he wants to be, because his character is he's an otaku who is like really into this stuff, and he plays all these like anime based games and stuff, and that's what he kind of wants to be, and that's kind of where I guess he gets his swagger. But at the same time, it's like he's sort of trying to live his fantasy, as horrible as it turns out for him. So I wanted to note that this level, the beach level, and you notice the enemies are all sort of military guys, and this kind of came out during the time when George W. Bush, the president of the United States, was had sent, the Iraq war was happening, and this was kind of like a nod to that, I think. I think this is sort of what this level was about.
Yeah, well, it's actually pretty interesting to me on that front. Because, I mean, it's the design of the military characters here is what makes this kind of a nod to like contemporary America, at least America of that time. Because when I was a kid, I grew up. I mean, my dad was like in special forces. I grew up on military bases, and the standard fatigue uniforms were the green, dark brown, basically a very green foresty. Colors and patterns, and that was the standard, fatigue set, because there was a greater likelihood of needing to be in a forested area, given given the theaters at that time. But starting with the escalation of the war in Iraq, or I should say the Middle East at this point, those colors changed to the desert colors that you're seeing now. And so that very much places it in that time frame. This is not a game that could have been designed, I would say, even like 3 or 4 years earlier with that way.
No, and I mean, like, it's obviously a nod or a commentary on it a little bit. I always find it also interesting when you get to the gun guys in this. They're military officers, but they shoot like gangsters. Like they hold their guns sideways.
I never put that together, but you're exactly right.
Apparently this because this beach supposedly is a beach that no one is supposed to go to. And like if you read like the actual story elements for this, essentially this beach is a wasteland, and you're not supposed to go here because the water is toxic. Even and it makes a note saying like the water is toxic, even though it looks pristine and clear. You do not want to swim at the beach in
right.
Sand to Destroy.
Yeah, I think because it is, I believe there's an industrial part of town that is like just up the way, and I think that there's a lot of toxicity that goes into the water from there. But you're exactly right. No, that's not something you would know on first sight. It's whether that's I'm undecided as to whether that's like the actual story or if that's like Travis's imagination. I mean, either way,
I think it was either in the manual or some of the supplementary material, but yeah, like I feel like also some of the stuff is through Travis's lens, and some of it's like not really true. It's just kind of what like he believes.
Right. Like that's kind of the make-believe world that he's in.
Also, you want to explain a little bit, because like you're actually really, really good at this game, but you're purposely kind of flubbing this so you can do the entire level with wrestling moves?
Yeah. I wanted to do two things. First is the guys with the guns I wanted to defeat with wrestling moves. And the other thing is the guys with the swords I wanted to defeat with the parries that you can do. I think of this as a punch the chip off my shoulder playthrough, because you basically have to get enemies to attack you, and then you have to parry their hits, which is why I'm taking more damage in this one than I usually do with the with these playthroughs.
The thing, like, actually about this game, which I think is really fun, is that a lot of the games that came out at the time, like, motion controls were a huge thing, and everybody was trying to do it. And I remember people were complaining that you only really use motion controls in this game on the finishers and stuff. And I think very wisely, they made the motions a reward in this game, where, because, like, otherwise you would just be flailing this remote and there would be almost no, it would just be kind of like luck based if you won or not.
Right.
Whereas in this game, the way they have this set up, you can very specifically block and target your lightsaber, and then once you've succeeded in doing your combo or whatever, then it rewards you with doing these different slashes and stuff. And I felt like it made it a lot more satisfying to get that final slash or to get the wrestling move.
Yeah.
After knowing you did super well with these combos or whatever you were doing, the parries and whatnot, or there's also the dark stepping too, which is a totally different thing.
Right. As a counterexample to this, in terms of Wii games that use the Wii remote as for a sword, I think of Twilight Princess. I played Twilight Princess as my first sort of Wii purchase.
I remember that game was just kind of like you flail the sword, and it wasn't very exacting.
Yeah. It wasn't like a one-to-one matchup with, you know, what you did with the remote. It just kind of registered that you flick the remote one way, so Link is going to swing his sword, so you kind of have to just waggle the remote around. And that was fun, but that actually tired my arm out quite a bit.
Right, yeah. Like, I think also with this game, Suda51 very much realized that having a person just, like, winging their arm around, they'll just get tired and they won't want to play the game. So instead, it becomes a reward. Like, it's like, oh, I get to do this awesome move, and I felt like I felt so much more in the moment that way. I got really into this game, like playing it. I just felt the actual battle system of it was a lot of fun, and just having that, you know, reward system made it not only fun to battle, but, like, it felt like as you played this game and you kept fighting the bosses and stuff, it felt like you were actually gaining, like, skill and strength, and you were actually doing it. And I think it's just sort of a trick of, like, giving enough and not too much.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a really good way of summing it up, or describing it. Yeah, it feels really good to do that final slash, or in my favorite are doing the wrestling moves.
And always learning them, and like, oh, you learned this one, you found the card to do this, now you can do this different suplex or whatever. It was always a lot of fun.
God, that's so frustrating. When I was recording this, I actually was using the original nunchuck for my Wii.
Oh, really?
It was like 10 years old, and it's like some of the whatever weights or balances or whatever inside that thing were really old and off. So, like, half the time, like, I was just, like, banging my controllers together trying to get, like, any wrestling move that required the nunchuck to work.
Nunchucks?
Oh, God, it was so frustrating. Eventually, I just got a new one. But, that's some pretty long-lasting hardware. I remember you got really into a lot of media hacking on this and the sequel. You pulled out a ton of the sound files. I also remember that you threw No More Heroes 2 into Dolphin, the Wii emulator, and you were playing with a bunch of stuff like pulling the shadows off and seeing what the textures look like. And if I remember right, you found that the textures are actually surprisingly high definition for the kind of output they get here.
Yeah, I was actually really surprised at the time, because this game, and indeed they did release this game in HD eventually, But I was very impressed by I was talking about it earlier, the I was very impressed by the modeling and just how, like, especially again in the faces and stuff, like how much detail there was in them and just how they focused on putting the detail where they needed it.
Right.
I went into the files because, like, I wanted to see if there's a game like this, and especially the sequel, there was so much unused content in these games that I was curious what was there. And then one thing I figured out about this game is that both the Japanese and English changes were on there. And the thing about this game is that in the Japanese version, there's not really as much gore. Like, all the exploding blood, all this exploding blood in the Japanese version is not there, which is interesting because I'm almost positive it makes playing the Japanese and UK version the speedrun choice, because that blood spurting out slows the game down, and it gets to be a ridiculous amount of blood.
I find it so gratifying to play this game and generate so much blood that it actually kind of breaks it a little bit.
Yeah. And I feel like actually the UK and the Japanese players sort of lost out on that a little bit.
This is how close it was in the knock the chip off my shoulder playthrough, down to literally one pixel.
I was like, I know he's way better than this. I like how you show, like, you sort of exploit the save room to get your health back.
Yes. Yeah, that's infinite pizza outdoors. But anyway, you were saying.
This game is all about cartoony violence, and I know people joke about cartoony violence, but this is really slapstick cartoon violence with all this, like, exploding heads. Like, when Holly Summers, like, eats the grenade, like,
right,
that could have been super gross, but it was like this sort of cartoony explosion, and her head gets blown off, and it's very silly in that way. And I think when this came out, there's a lot of talk about the violence in it and how it treated violence and how, like, should people be concerned about it and stuff like that. If I remember at the time, it was interesting. And like, of course, in America, we get all the beheadings and everything.
Right. Beheadings have a political connotation in Japan, if I recall right.
Because all the... for instance, if you play Resident Evil 4 in Japan, when the chainsaw guy in the American version, he can cut your head off. But in the Japanese version, instead, he will bisect you. He'll just cut you in half instead of cutting your head off if he gets you.
Really?
Yeah, it's complete. Any game that's like that with a beheading, at least now, is completely different, because I don't think it's not that I don't think that they can not put it in there, but I think if you put a beheading in the game, it automatically rates it as a Cero Z. Certainly this game, if it had come out with all this blood and gore, it would have been automatically a Z rating in Japan.
Right.
And Z is like...
like AO here?
No, it's not so much like AO. It's like a mature in terms of content, but it's like an AO in terms of placement in the stores.
Okay.
So, like, if you get a Z rating, the major stores will not stock your game in Japan.
Right,
so
which is the same as making it unreleasable.
Yeah, exactly. So only the boutique stores will release it. So that's why, like, they try to generally avoid Z rating games. And the ones that come out are lower print runs and that kind of thing. So the choice to remove the blood from this game and just the content they removed from this game in Japan was not so much a choice of... a censorship choice, but a choice of being able to actually market it in Japan.
Right.
Like, I believe all the Grand Theft Auto games, or at least the recent ones, are all automatically Z rating. And the thing is those games aren't super popular in Japan anyway.
Sure.
So they can get away with releasing it in lower numbers and stuff like that.
I want to ask you something. This is a part of this fight that I actually have a lot of questions over. This fight is unique because it has two parts.
Mm-hmm.
It has an opening with kind of jaunty, almost jokey music. And you can actually attack her, and she'll do all of her moves and everything. But that jokey music ends the first time you fall into one of these sand holes. And then it cuts that, it cues that cutscene where she throws the three hand grenades in there and boom, 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 and that sort of thing. But yeah, so this game breaks the fight into two parts, which I think is pretty unique. And I wanted to know, what do you think about that?
I feel like it's probably a nod back to like older games where like, you know, the older Mega Man games or whatever, where you'd have like, oh, this is the first form of the character, and then they transform, and here's the second form, and like, I feel like it's kind of like that sort of, like, to me, it just felt like very video gamey, where you sort of have to figure out like how to get the character to their like next mode.
Right, and this one it's particularly easy because all you have to do is fall into a hole.
So now that you're actually getting to the boss, and we're talking about the character of this game before, like I think above and beyond what makes this game compelling is kind of like that they compelling in a way that makes you want to keep fighting the assassins. They do a good job of making the assassins seem like they have more than that makes them tick beyond just being bosses in a video game.
Yeah.
Be it like little hints of their life beyond your battle. Like I remember, you know, you sort of learn a little bit about Dr. Peace and like his daughter and a little bit about that. And like, you know, or they get philosophical about stuff before, you know, you kill them or that kind of thing. And so they give you enough so you feel like these characters exist out there in this weird world of Sand and Destroy without, like, you know, novelizing it. I think the biggest counterexample is if you played Metal Gear Solid 4, where the bosses are completely sort of name, like, other than having a name and sort of a gimmick,
right?
They just exist. And then after you defeat them, you're just sort of given this sob story about, oh, this is how their horrible life there was, and there's not anything really compelling about them as characters. They might be fun to fight. Like, all those bosses were kind of fun to fight and figure out their gimmicks and whatever, but they weren't compelling characters.
Right.
Whereas I feel like this game, in its weird sort of, like, weird way, is like all the assassins in this game are very compelling. They're fun to fight, and so they sort of explain things about their character during like their interactions, and this game sort of does in those short interactions what, like, I guess MGS4 wishes it could have done. Like,
right. Yeah.
It's very juxtaposed, and this is like the design of these bosses are a lot like the early Metal Gear Solid bosses, where there would be a lot of character development, and where you would be interested in fighting them.
Yeah.
And this game makes you interested in fighting characters.
Yeah, now that's a really fine distinction. Yeah, which is ironic because I think that between the two, I think No More Heroes is more video gamey, a video game. I mean, even though the Metal Gear series has its sort of token self-awareness, with Metal Gear Solid 4, it was very interested in, you know, immersing you in the story and trying to get you into that fictional world. Whereas I think No More Heroes is much more explicitly like, haha, it's a video game. So it's ironic that this game wound up being the one with the personality, and Metal Gear Solid 4 wound up being the one that just felt gamey.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, this game sort of like lives in meta. Like the UI is very specifically old school pixels. And like sprites and the weird tiger in the corner and gauges and all sorts of like very, you know, it's like, we know this is a video game. And like, I imagine like this is what's in Travis's mind, like why he's doing this. Like he sort of imagines it as a video game.
Yeah, that's how I read it. That's like, this is how he perceives combat as combat reticules, as life bars. But something else here. You know, the characters are often more described in their character designs than you know, outright storytelling. And I think it's really interesting that Holly Summers, she is for some reason associated with military and explosives and stuff like that. And she's also got a prosthetic leg, which I think, I mean, if we're looking at movie references, I think is a nod to some Quentin Tarantino thing. But it's also interesting because she uses explosives and there are landmines everywhere, and she's missing a leg, which implies that she got it blown off. So it's really neat, that little detail of that's never explained how she lost her leg, but because she plays with explosives, you got maybe an idea as to how that might have come about.
And this game doesn't feel the need to be like, well, when I was 10 years old, my dad taught me about explosives and I blew up my leg, but...
No!
There's enough there that you can kind of make your own story in your head, and it's just as valid as any other.
Forgive me, number six. I never meant to shame you.
The ending to this, the way this fight ended, left one of the... I couldn't tell if it was a sour taste in my mouth or what. but it affected me, and I kind of... I still don't know what I think about it.
Well, I mean, I kind of felt that, like, the cartoony violence in this, I feel like, juxtaposes the scene, because it's such as silly as a game as it is, it's suddenly this whole thing about the seriousness of death and taking a life, right? Like, what Travis does is he's killing people, and he has to take a life. And I feel like this is, like, a little bit of a nod to the boss from Metal Gear Solid 3, where you have to, you sort of have to kill her. But this is, you have to bury her pretty much. Like,
interesting.
Because they make you go to the thing here, right? Like, you don't, because they could have just cut right to this cutscene of Travis putting her in the ground.
Right.
Whereas this pretty much forces you to bury her.
Yeah. Yeah. You have to.
I kind of, I like how you're doing kicks here.
Yep. His one pouty thing he can do. But, I mean, even right down to how slowly Travis moves, you have to sort of feel the weight of that death in a way, literally there. I guess it's interesting that part of her theme is that she's philosophical and talks about the meaning of death and fear and all that other stuff. And Travis is very flippant about that. But something at some point, it touches him.
That affects him, yeah. Like, I think it's... kind of like saying, you know, this is a video game, but death still means something. Killing people still means something.
Yeah, that's something that the game revisits every so often. It happened after the death metal fight and also after the Dr. Peace fights, where even though Travis is victorious, he's like, I'm not feeling the sense of satisfaction I feel I should here. And that cutscene right there is maybe the most heavy-handed one of them. Well, that brings us to the end of Heaven 5, Travis's fight against Holly Summers. Brady, thank you very much for joining me on this. And again, super cool that you worked on the instruction manual for the PS3 version.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you very much for having me.
See you next time, everyone.